was dark in the Kruger Park, and the animals on the prowl. When through the night there came a mighty terrifying howl. 'Twas Bonds of Father Baboon who cried, "With this humble life I'm not satisfied. I want to do the things a baboon's never tried and go to the human's land." He said, "Goodbye, my friends, I thought since I'm off on Rüchering's dints. I'm going to try my hand in the human's land, 'cause his life in the game reserve stinks." As he left the gate, he tumbled straight on a mainline railway. Having little to do, pulled a lever or two to pass the time away. Now it came to pass that the signal man was fast asleep in the luggage van, and the blue train heading for the bandstand was now back on its course. So the people said, "Hip hooray, Bonds of Fire, you've saved the day. But for your deed, a catastrophe would surely have come our way." So on they sped, Bonds of Fire at the head, till they reached Johannesburg. And when he got there, didn't stop or stare, but obeyed his primitive urge. For hearing afar a familiar bark, he traced it at once to Ellis Park, and seeing what he thought was a pretty good lark, he dashed onto the field. And the crowd said, "Look at that, oh, yes, man, just watch him go. Watch him fly, he's gonna score a try. Die Welt straight is also no." But the very next day he was on his way to the Parliament in Cape Town. And naturally, inquisitive, he began to look around. And tiptoeing in through the lobby door, he stood at last on the chamber floor. And the House said, "He's just what we're looking for. Let's send him to the UNO. Oh, give him a brand new suit and a diplomatic brief to boot. Give a smart umbrella to this mighty fine fella. He really is gonna look cute." Well, you'd never guess the great success that awaited Bonds of Fire. For in diplomacy he showed that he was quite spectacular. During his first delivery, the assembly listened attentively and decided his language was positively international. And the diplomats suddenly were all barking happily. All major decisions and national ambitions were settled instantly. But we can't pretend that that was the end of Bonds of Fire's great mission. As I understand, he lent a hand to the advance of nuclear fission. For such was his charm and common sense that he quickly won the confidence of world premiers and presidents, who came to his house for lunch. They arrived covered in smiles, with blueprints of their latest missiles, and all constructions for mass destruction, plans of their new atomic piles. And they offered them politely for Bonds of Fire scrutiny, who after several checks took off his specs and ate them for his lunch.